Hello, this is Jennifer Pizzuto coming to you from AAN 2017. I am joined with Dr. Uc from the University of Iowa, who's here to talk to us about aging and neurological disorders and the ways that exercise can be particularly effective in the management of these diseases.
Well, thank you. So there is increasing recognition about the role of exercise. Even a presidential panel convened in 2008 and came up with physical exercise guidelines for Americans. And these recommendations were also accepted by the American Heart Association. And the recommendation in general for physical exercise is to have 2.5 hours of moderate aerobic exercise per week in a healthy adult person. And there is strong support for this recommendation, and also there is pretty good support to do at least 2 days of resistance type of exercise, meaning like weightlifting. But of course, in all this, safety must come first. Now, of course, there are other forms of exercises, but I will speak mainly about these two for now, especially aerobic exercise. So for aerobic exercise, you need to break a sweat and to increase your heart rate beyond a certain amount. And there is research that shows, of course, as expected in aging, aerobic exercise improves aerobic fitness. However, there is also some accumulating evidence that in sedentary elderly, aerobic exercise also improve abilities other than physical function, such as even cognitive functions. So, especially in people with some impairment, there could be improvements in their executive functions, which are an important part of cognition. One critical thing is that all these exercises need to be done safely. And also, before before assuming a certain exercise regimen, one needs to make sure that it is a sound recommendation and that it was subjected to rigorous scientific method to show its effect. Okay. Now, one more area of training is cognitive training. So especially computerized games have been rather popular these days. And there are big claims that they improve cognition. However, although there are again some promising preliminary data on that, there ought to be scientifically rigorous clinical trials to confirm their effect. So one should not believe all advertisements with a blind faith and look for such proof. Still, keeping social and mental engagement with surroundings, I think will help anybody aging or with some neurological disease.
So something important that I heard you say there is that cognitive exercise is just as important as physical exercise. So could you give us an example of the sort of cognitive exercise that someone could do just to keep brain functionality happening?
Well, I'm not sure if I said exactly just as important, but so one has really to be careful. So I don't want to endorse any particular exercise regimen, but and there are many abound offered online. But my general warning is that one should be cautious about accepting the claims. Mm-hmm. So, however, it's important to keep social engagement and engage in activities that keep your mind sharp, not necessarily games. So, of course, if one enjoys games and doesn't have other option, they could do that. It probably won't hurt. But in general, I just recommend not being a couch potato or a passive person in front of a TV, but keep your life engaged in various physical and cognitive activities.
So basically, to kind of engage in conversation and socialization with other people and keep those neurons active for as long as possible. Yes. But what about maybe, and I know that you said there's no specific thing that cognitively will help, like specifically, but what about things like crossword puzzles and puzzles like those kinds of things to make people really think and use those brain cells?
Sure. So now, there have been a number of studies on different cognitive training regimens. So what these studies show is that you improve on what you are being trained. You know, you are doing a certain task, so your performance on that task gets better. But the performance, the improved performance on that task does not necessarily translate to other cognitive tasks on which you are not trained for. And also, there is no strong evidence that these improvements on the task you are trained for translating into benefits, into functions in real life. So that's what we need to be careful about. So the concept of transfer to real life and untrained tasks is very important.
So they're not necessarily generalizable. Okay, that's great. Thank you so much for all of that very interesting information. I would like to shift topics, if I might, just for one second. I would like to talk about diet. What do you recommend as far as diet in aging and individuals with neurological disorders? What are the best things to consume, to stay away from?
Okay. Well, stay away from junk food, I would say. Yeah. So there is... there are studies, which epidemiological studies, which show that Mediterranean diet, you know, diet rich in olive oil and vegetables, fruits, rather than processed foods, is associated with less occurrence of future dementia, even Parkinson's disease. Of course, these do not show causality. They only show that they only help us to generate hypotheses about the mechanisms of these effects. But so certainly one should really as much as possible adhere to more healthy diet. You know, eating your fruits, vegetables, and staying away from processed foods, what we always tell our children.
Well, thank you so much for all the information that you've given us today. We really appreciate it. Is there anything else that you would like to add as far as diet or nutrition goes?
I would just like to summarize, you know, caution mm-hmm. and safety first. Mm-hmm. Stay away from hype. Interventions, unless there is strong proof and confirmation by reliable agencies. Thank you.
Thank you so much.